Sri, now we go to special mention, Sri Narayan Bhai Ratwa. Narayan Bhai Ratwa. Narayan Bhai Ratwa. Please, please. You can't, you have to make a request to me. You can't ask the minister up. Narayan Bhai Ratwa. If you want to respond, he will respond. Please. Bajjai. Bajjai, please. If you want to respond, he will respond. He will ask me. He will ask. Please. Please. Nothing will go on record, including what has been said earlier. Narayan Bhai Ratwa. Nothing will go on record which has been removed.
केंद्रीय सचिवालय सेवा
ये तो पद्धति नहीं आई विल नॉट अलाउ दिस आई एम टेलिंग यू इफ एवरीबॉडी स्टैंड्स अप एंड देन अकॉर्डिंग टू अपना मर्जी से बोलना शुरू करें कमेंट करें
किंतु कुछ कारणों से
एवरीबॉडी इज गेटिंग एन अपॉर्चुनिटी एवरीबॉडी इज गेटिंग अपॉर्चुनिटी यू मस्ट अंडरस्टैंड ऑल साइड्स नारायण भाई
सर विषय केंद्रीय सचिवालय सेवा में पदोन्नति प्रारंभ करने के संबंध में केंद्रीय सचिवालय सेवा देश में सबसे पुरानी संगठित सेवाओं में से एक है जो प्रशासनिक कार्य की रीढ़ के रूप में काम करती है किंतु कुछ कारणों से केंद्रीय सचिवालय सेवा में सेवा के सभी संवर्गों में प्रमोशन को एक बार फिर से रोक दिया गया है जबकि दूसरी अन्य सभी सर्विसों में पदोन्नति का कार्य अनवरत जारी है। पिछले वर्षों में भी केंद्रीय सचिवालय सेवा में प्रमोशन रुका पड़ा था। पदोन्नति में देरी होने से केंद्रीय सचिवालय सेवा के इन अधिकारियों का मनोबल और उत्साह प्रभावित हो रहा है। अधिकारी बिना पदोन्नति के सेवानिवृत्त हो रहे हैं और उसका उनके सेवानिवृत्ति लाभों पर भी प्रतिकूल प्रभाव पड़ रहा है। यह समझ से पर है कि बार बार केंद्रीय सचिवालय सेवा में ही प्रमोशन क्यों रोक दिया जाता है जबकि दूसरी अन्य सेवाओं में पदोन्नति की प्रक्रिया जारी रहती है। मैं इस सदन के माध्यम से कार्मिक और प्रशिक्षण विभाग के राज्य मंत्री से केंद्र सचिवालय सेवा के विभिन्न संवर्गों में सभी रिक्त पदों पर पदोन्नति के लिए तत्काल कार्रवाई करने और उपर्युक्त सभी रिक्तियों को पात्र उप सचिव अपर सचिव अनुभाग अधिकारियों सहायक अनुभाग अधिकारियों से अविलंबित भरे जाने का अनुरोध करता हूँ। साथ ही मैं यह भी सुझाव देना चाहता हूँ कि केंद्रीय सचिवालय सेवा के सभी संवर्गों में पदोन्नति का कार्य पूर्व की भांति मासिक या त्रिमासिक स्तर पर प्रारंभ किया जाए।
धन्यवाद नारायण भाई। प्रोफेसर मनोज कुमार झा।
ऑनरेबल चेयरमैन सर फॉर अलाउइंग मी टू रेज दिस इम्पोर्टेंट कंसर्न सर पोस्ट ग्रेजुएट सीट्स एंड यूजी एमबीबीएस मेडिकल सीट्स अलॉटेड अंडर ऑल इंडिया कोटा फॉर ओबीसी स्टूडेंट्स हैव नॉट बीन इम्प्लीमेंटेड in all India quota seats pooled from states. Thereby, OBC students are denied more than 3,000 seats every year. In 2018-19, under all India quota for PG medical admission, out of 7972 seats, OBCs got only 222 instead of 2152. Similarly, under UG seats, out of 4061 seats, only 66, whereas it should have been 1096. For the seats drawn from the states for the All India quota, SCSTs are provided 15% and 7.5%. In the same way, OBC students should be provided 27% in All India PG seats, as also in AIQ, that is pooled seats drawn from states. It is a fact that OBC reservation percentage varies from state to state. So is the case with SCST, whose percentage also vary from state to state. Thus, the variation in OBC reservation percentage should not be the reason for denying 27% reservation in All India quota UG and PG seats pooled from states. PG diploma seats, which is now converted to degree seats, is being given to EWS category only. And it should be extended to all categories as earlier. While introducing EWS reservation, it was told that there shall be 20% increase of seats so that other category reservation shall not be affected, which did not happen. I request that the medical PG seats, which have been increased owing to the changes of MCI rules out of teacher-student ratio, should be provided to all and not only for the EWS. Thank you very much, Honorable Chairman, sir.
Sri B.K. Hariprasad.
Thank you, Chairman, sir. I would like to draw the attention of this August House regarding the damage to the cultural legacy. Sir, India doesn't have the heritage protection laws Jordan's GDP is less than 2% of India's, yet they have an enforcement agency for heritage. Sir, our country are exhibited in the northern and western countries, which includes world
stolen antics.
Sir, stolen antics of our country are exhibited in the northern and western countries, which includes world's largest cut diamonds, the famous Kohinoor. Recently, the statue of Saint Thirumanakkai Alvar was acquired by the Ashmolean Museum at the University of Oxford from South Besa. Action House in 1967 from the collection of a collector named J.R. Belmont between 1886 and 1981. Does the government have any consolidated list for repatriation of the stolen sculptures or any roadmap for this, or any support is given to the Indian person or group who have claimed restore our cultural legacy from any other country? Some research claims that over $700 million worth of Indian art and antiquities entered the U.S. just in declared imports over the last decade. Whether the government has identified the recent smugglers who deals in exporting Indian art, the 1970 UNESCO Convention prohibits and, however,
prevents
the illicit import, export and transfer of ownership of cultural property, and so does UN Resolution 2347. Sir, however, countries are not sanctioned or forced to comply, so it is up to the government intention and willingness to restore their cultural heritage. It is also necessary to look into the insensitiveness and ill-treatment for returned idols which are kept in warehouses of the archaeological department. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, sir. A concerned minister, take note of it. Culture ministry is there? No. It's okay. Sri S. Muthukaruppan.
My special mention is permission to import of peas through Thoothukudi seaport in Tamil Nadu, sir. Tamil Nadu has over 1,000 micro, small and medium dal and flour mills for processing different varieties of peas, and thereby provides direct employment opportunity to around 50,000 laborers and direct employment to over 65,000 persons. There is a heavy demand for peas in Tamil Nadu, Puducherry and Kerala, as peas is used for preparing traditional snacks in the south. Peas, especially green peas, are cultivated in Tamil Nadu only in an extent of 120 hectares with production of about 1,960 metric tons. The requirement of peas for Tamil Nadu is about 2 lakh metric tons, and this has to be met by importing peas from other countries. In this scenario, Direct General of Foreign Trade has on 18-12-2019 issued a public notification imposing a restriction on the import of peas to 1.5 lakh metric ton for the entire country. Due to this restriction, the cost of peas has drastically increased to over rupees 65 per kilogram in Tamil Nadu. This ban has detrimentally affected the dal and flour mills operating as MSME units in Tamil Nadu, and therefore affecting the livelihood of laborers and others who depend on this trade. This restriction has resulted in shortage of peas, and cost of green peas has gone up in Tamil Nadu. I appeal to the government of India to permit the import of all varieties of peas, including yellow peas and green peas, through Thoothukudi seaport, and safeguard the interest of dal and flour milling trade in Tamil Nadu as well as the neighboring southern states. Thank you very much, sir.
The problem is, you have to understand what will happen to the agriculturists who are growing peas. That is also an issue that has to be kept in mind. Import and export, while taking care of our own Indian producers. Sri Rakesh Sinha.
Mananiya Sabhapati Mahoday, main aapke madhyam se fast food ke sambandh mein apna special mention rakhta hoon. भारत में फास्ट फूड का प्रसार तेजी से बढ़ता जा रहा है. एक अनुमान के अनुसार देश में इसका बाजार मूल्य 27.5 बिलियन डॉलर है. शोध में यह बात सामने आई है कि फास्ट फूड का सेवन करने वालों लोगों में एंटीबायोटिक्स का असर कम होता है और इसके अनेक ड्रग्स का रेजिस्टेंस डेवलप उनमें कर जाता है। इसे एंटी माइक्रोबियल रेजिस्टेंस कहते हैं। इसका कारण फूड एनिमल प्रोडक्शन में एंटीबायोटिक्स का उपयोग किया जा रहा है। भारत के 2/3 पोल्ट्री फार्म्स में जल्दी ग्रोथ के लिए भरपूर एंटीबायोटिक्स का उपयोग किया जा रहा है। यही चिकन फूड में भी हमें यही परोसा जा रहा है। देश के कुल फास्ट फूड मार्केट का 45% वेजिटेरियन है। पश्चिम के देशों में इस खतरे को देखते हुए 2017 में एंटीबायोटिक्स का फूड एनिमल प्रोडक्शन में रोक लगा दिया गया। 2020 तक यह संभवतः यह पूर्ण होगा। अमेरिका में सख्त कानून बनाया गया है। भारत में भी फास्ट फूड के मैकडोनाल्ड KFC जैसे बड़े ब्रांड हैं जो USA में भी हैं, पर इन कंपनियों का दोहरा मापदंड है। जहां वे USA में फास्ट फूड को एंटीबायोटिक से मुक्त करने का काम कर रहे हैं, वहीं भारत में वे ऐसा करने की प्रतिबद्ध मंशा नहीं दिखा रहे हैं। फास्ट फूड को स्वादिष्ट बनाने के लिए अनेक ऐसे मसालों का उपयोग होता है जो स्वास्थ्य के लिए हानिकारक है। एंटीबायोटिक्स के रेजिस्टेंस की बढ़ती समस्या का एक बड़ा कारण फास्ट फूड है। इस दिशा में जागरूकता के साथ सख्त कदम उठाने की जरूरत है। धन्यवाद।
इस इंस्टेंट फूड मींस कांस्टेंट डिजीज, दिस हैज टू बी अंडरस्टूड बाय ऑल। श्री हां, आई एग्री, प्लीज वेट, आई एग्री। श्री के सोमा प्रसाद
सर, द सब्जेक्ट इज द नीड ऑफ इंजीनियरिंग रेगुलेटरी मैकेनिज्म। द इंजीनियरिंग टेक्नोलॉजी प्ले ए key role in the development and economic growth of our country. It elevates the standard of living, adds comfort to life, and brings jobs and homes to men. This is the reason for the high privilege of engineers in the society. Engineering is the largest segment of Indian industry. There are 10,396 engineering institutes in India, but only a few institutes are imparting quality education. AICT is the only system set out for the qualitative improvement in technical education, maintenance of norms and standards in engineering education. But the area of operations of AICTs are limited. There is no professional or statutory council to check and measure the professional ethics of engineers. It is highly essential to establish a statutory body which imparts high standard of engineering education, grants recognition and accreditation of engineering colleges, grant registration to engineering graduates, prescribing professional conduct and ethic propriety with the disciplinary jurisdiction like NMC, BCI, INC, etc., which are functioning as the professional regulatory bodies in the respective areas. Hence, my appeal is that necessary steps may be taken to establish a professional statutory and regulatory system in the engineering field also. Thank you, sir.
Thank you very much, Om Prasad ji. Sri Kailash Soni. Sri Kailash Soni.
Dhanyavad, Mananiya Sabhapati Mahoday. Is special mention ke madhyam se lokhit ke is mudde ko uthana chahta hu. Sare desh mein sahkari bankon aur societyon ki bigadti paristhiti ko sudharne ke liye purvarti sarkar ne सुधार के लिए प्रोफेसर बैद्यनाथन की अध्यक्षता में आयोग बनाया था। उसकी सिफारिश पर नाबार्ड द्वारा सरकारी बैंकों के अंतर्गत काम करने वाली सात सहकारी समितियों को, जिनकी रिकवरी 30% थी, पुनः संस्थाओं को खड़ा करने के लिए आर्थिक सहायता दी एवं स्टेट गवर्नमेंटों की तरफ से एग्रीमेंट किया गया कि सरकार सहकारी बैंकों एवं समितियों में राजनीतिक नियुक्तियाँ नहीं करेगी, केवल कृषक एवं जमाकर्ता संस्था चलाएंगे। पैसा लेने के बाद वचनबद्धता को तोड़ते हुए कानून बदलकर राजनीतिक नियुक्तियां की गई हैं। इतना ही नहीं, कर्ज मुक्ति माफी के पूर्ति के नाम पर सरकारों द्वारा बिना पैसा दिए सोसाइटियों को कर्ज मुक्ति के लिए बाध्य किया जा रहा है, जिससे किसानों की अंश पूंजी को खतरा हो गया है। इस कारण सरकारी बैंक सुरक्षित नहीं है, क्योंकि सोसाइटियों में सहकारी बैंकों का पैसा लगा हुआ है। सारे सहकारी बैंक रिजर्व बैंक के लाइसेंसी हैं। इन्हें रिजर्व बैंक के अंतर्गत किया जावे, जिससे सहकारिता जो ग्रामीण अर्थरचना की रीढ़ है सुरक्षित रहे, अन्यथा सहकारी समितियां एवं बैंक खतरे में हो जाएंगे। धन्यवाद।
धन्यवाद जी। श्रीमती कांता करदम।
बहुत बहुत आभार सभापति महोदय जी। सभापति महोदय, मैं उत्तर प्रदेश के मेरठ ज़िले से आती हूँ। हमारे यहाँ मेरठ में एक पासपोर्ट सेवा केंद्र है जो कि मेरठ कैंट में स्थित है। इस बिल्डिंग की हालत बहुत ही जर्जर अवस्था में है। आम जनता के लिए पासपोर्ट ऑफिस में ना ही पीने के पानी की व्यवस्था है तथा ना ही शौचालय की व्यवस्था है। पासपोर्ट सेवा केंद्र में एसी की सुविधा भी उपलब्ध नहीं है जिसके कारण आए दिन कंप्यूटर खराब रहते हैं तथा आम जनता को कठिनाइयों का सामना करना पड़ता है और एक ही काम के लिए बार बार पासपोर्ट ऑफिस के चक्कर लगाने पड़ते हैं। कैंट क्षेत्र में होने के कारण यहाँ मोबाइल कनेक्टिविटी भी नहीं है जिसके कारण लोगों को बहुत दिक्कत होती है। अतः आपके माध्यम से मेरा आग्रह है कि पासपोर्ट ऑफिस को मेरठ कैंट से निकालकर मेरठ शहर में खोला जाए तथा सभी मूलभूत सुविधाओं से सर्जित किया जाए जिससे लोगों को पासपोर्ट ऑफिस की सुविधा का लाभ मिल सके। धन्यवाद।
धन्यवाद जी, कांता जी। डॉक्टर अमर पटनायक।
Thank you, sir, for giving me this permission to raise a very important issue relating to carbon sinks and afforestation measures. So, compensatory afforestation is one of the conditions stipulated by the central government while approving proposals for diverting use of forest land under the Forest Act. In 2019, the government released ₹47,436 crore to states for compensatory afforestation. Implementation of these projects is crucial. Forests serve as an additional utility of trapping and storing vast reserves of atmospheric carbon dioxide as carbon sinks. Under Article 4 of the Paris Agreement, as part of its intended nationally determined contributions, India had pledged to create an additional carbon sink of 2.5 to 3 billion tons of carbon dioxide equivalent through additional forest cover by 2030. The government can leverage afforestation activities to meet its target while addressing statutory forest conservation requirements. This is vital as atmospheric carbon dioxide concentration has reached a global level of 413 particles per million against Earth's historical average of 280 ppm. In normal circumstances, this practice is taken up over an equivalent area of non-forest land. However, this does not compensate the ecological loss, damage to water resources and soil erosion. As per recent data released by the Ministry of Environment and Forests, 7 states had no CA activities for non-forest land approved in the year 2018-19. 8 states did not have any such projects approved under degraded forest land. I demand that the government introduce both incentives and punitive measures to ensure afforestation is taken up by all states. This CA requirement be raised to 2 times of the diverted forest land in specific cases of significant ecological degradation and biospheric restoration be concurrently taken up. Thank you, sir.
Sri Manas Ranjan Bunia.
Thank you, Chairman, sir. The IIT Kharagpur has set up one beautiful medical institute. This will work and provide service to the people and patients in the district of Pashchim Medinipur and the adjoining areas of the districts and adjoining states, Odisha, Jharkhand, and other states. This is the first medical institute which will work jointly with the IIT Kharagpur. Interestingly, the technological expertise, including the technological expertise of the engineering knowledge and the medical excellence, the biotechnological excellence combined with engineering essence will give the best possible medical service from this institute. This medical institute should be the nerve center of the medical academics and the research in our country. Dr. Siddharth Ghosh, an eminent medical expert and noted neurosurgeon of our country, has been nominated as the advisor of the institute. The government of India should consider the name of Dr. Siddharth Ghosh, the asset of our country, to be made the medical director of this institute to make this institute a complete and efficient institute. more funding should be given for the more development of this institute in my district in Kharagpur town. Sir.
Thank you, Sri Vijay Goyal.
Thank you, sir. Sir, recent crisis at Yes Bank and moratorium imposed by the Reserve Bank has highlighted the need of urgent corporate governance reforms in India. Financial crisis at private banks put hard-earned money of lakhs of people at risk. In the past, we have seen changes in the board of ICICI Bank and Axis Bank before the Maharashtra Cooperative Bank scam case had surfaced too. It is appreciable that the government has come up with the restructuring scheme for Yes Bank. We need to take urgent steps to ensure that banks do not go insolvent because of various reasons. For this, I suggest that, firstly, RBI should amend its corporate governance rules so that such issues can be identified beforehand and can be dealt with in earlier stages. Secondly, Honorable Finance Minister had recently increased the deposit insurance scheme from 1 lakh to 5 lakh, which is appreciable. However, a lot of MSMEs and corporates also hold bank accounts in private banks, and 5 lakhs is a meager amount for them. Those businesses do business with worth crores, so the deposit insurance scheme for corporate and business should be increased.
Vijayji, over.
I hope that the government will consider this.
I would like to make a mention that no member of the House should avoid before appearing before any investigating agency when she or he is called upon to do so by citing the reason of the House duty. As lawmakers, it is our bounden duty to respect the law and legal procedures. It applies to all in all cases, because you can only inform House is in session, give me further date, but you cannot avoid the enforcing agencies or the law enforcing agencies summons or notices. This has to be taken note by all. But, why you thank me? That's the question. The question 271.